In 1967, Howard Sams came out with a photofact, including this circuit trace concept of theirs, which was about a unique machine that existed in the marketplace. But like all machines, it needed service, and so they came out with a service manual for this company that made this machine. Telectro, model number SS233. And here it is. This is probably one of the last surviving model SS233 tape recorders in existence. That lovely piece of music for our introduction is called The Broke Coffee House, and it is available through the YouTube audio library, or you can actually find it on YouTube itself as a video. The composer is Doug Maxwell, and he has allowed everybody to use this music royalty and copyright free. Now, the sound you heard is mono because this stereo tape recorder cannot record. I've chased down all the problems that I can find, and I think what it is there's a switch here, which we will look at in a little bit, and that switch handles the recording capability, and I don't think it's functioning properly. Let's take a tour of this machine. Well, first of all, it is a AC unit, of course, and it comes in a case with two speakers on each side. The actual mechanics and electronics are all contained in this area, and this all lifts out after you remove quite a few screws. So that's how you get into a service. It is also a tube machine, which in the UK I think they call valve machines, and there is a provision on the back of the machine, which we will see, for removing a plate, and when you remove the plate you can change out the tubes, which is something that people in the 1960s were very used to doing with their electronics. Let's have a little history of Telectro, the company, and then we'll have the history of this particular machine. Telectro, the company, was founded quite a while before the 1960s, and it was founded by a European gentleman whose name was not Mr. Telectro. I forget what his name was, but you can Google Telectro on the internet and find information about the Telectro company. Long story short, they were making tape recorders, and you can find these tape recorders on eBay. Most of them were mono, and I believe they were making them for other retailers. The one that I noticed the most was Radio Shack, had some Telectro models that they offered in the 60s. Now, what happened to Telectro? Well, at the same time, around 1965, the Japanese manufacturers were pumping out a lot of product and exporting it to the United States. And their products were cheaper than American products because they had, you know, obviously they had lower manufacturing costs. So Telectro, among many other manufacturers in the United States, was having a really hard time keeping up financially. And the sales apparently were not that brisk, and they got into financial difficulty, and Emerson Radio picked them up. Emerson Radio had been around for a very long time, and had been making radios and record players probably since the 1930s. And their name was well established, but they did not have a tape recorder department. So when Telectro became available, they purchased Telectro. And that's why you will see Telectro by Emerson Radio. So that's the history of Telectro as a company. Now, what about this tape recorder? Well, it came from eBay, and it was actually in cosmetic condition, was excellent. The speaker grill cloth is very clean. There's been no marks, nothing on here, no scratches, no dents, no dings. Just the machine was quite dirty. And, of course, it was DOA. It was dead when it arrived. So, well, I had to go inside and find out what was wrong with the machine. Now, it had mechanical problems and it had electrical problems. The mechanical problems had to do with the speed. I'm pointing to the speed control now. because it's a belt drive machine and the belt had stretched. So the lower speed was not working properly. It was dragging. Then the other part of it was the electronics. And as usual, capacitors, very bad problem. Had to replace them. And you'll see more about that later on. So I restored the machine. It won't record, but it will play back in all three speeds. Let's take a look at all of the functions. There is a switch here, which is very mysterious. I don't know what it's called, but you have to put it in this position for stereo playback, and then you put it in this position when you want to stereo record. So it has to be up for stereo mono playback. Here we have the function control that's for playback and record. Now when you turn it over here, it plays, and when you turn it over here, it records. Watch. Now, if I wanted to record, I would press this button in. That's the interlock. And then I would rotate this in this direction. Now, obviously, I'm not going to do that because I don't want to erase the tape. But you can see here it says record. We have two inputs for microphone, left and right. We already looked at the interlock. Now we have the fast forward rewind lever. Not from this control. This control only has three positions. This is how you manage it. Similar to some of the Akai and Roberts machines. Now, to go to fast forward, you push it at the bottom towards the reel that's going to be collecting. And there's fast forward. And you have to hold it. It will not lock down. Now, if you want to rewind, you push it towards the reel that will be collecting. The next thing is the speed control. Now the speed control is a little strange. Okay, there's a knob here, and if you push the knob in, it's supposed to slow down the belt. And so now it's going at a slower speed. It's going half speed. I think we can agree that was half speed. If we pull it out, it goes to the upper one, the upper step on the motor. So at this point, we're playing at 7.5 inches per second. And before we were at 3.75. Now, the other way you change speeds is with the capstan. That's why it's sticking out. It's a sleeve, and you could pull it out. And believe it or not, the motor, the capstan spins underneath the sleeve. I don't know how they make that work, but it does work. Now, when that's pulled out, the shaft for the capstan flywheel is exposed. The raw shaft itself, which is, of course, obviously smaller than this. So, because that's, you know, sliding on top of it. So, that also goes to a lower speed. We should hear this thing playing at half speed. So we did hear it playing at half speed. Now, if you push this in, and now it's going to be at quarter speed. This is 1.875 inches per second. No point listening to a lot of that. Pull it out, we're back up to speed. Push this in, we're back up to 7.5. We have a switch here for recording level. Now there's a meter right down here, and it's just a simple VU meter, and this switch controls which channel this meter will register. So when it's on A, it's this channel, and when it's on B, it's this channel, and when it's on PA, it's still on this channel, so you'll still see the A. I mean, you'll still see the meter working. So that works when you have microphones. And I do have the original microphones from the machine. They're stored in the back. And here is a genuine Telectro model SS233 stereo microphone. And these microphones do work. because I can use them for PA. I'm not going to demonstrate that, but they do work. So there it is. We see the tape recorder. We see how this all works. We have a three-digit counter here, which has a thumb wheel reset, volume tone, and this has a feature on it. There's a switch. Now, when the switch is not on, channel A is here, channel B is here. When the switch is on, channel A plays through both speakers. This grill has four screws. You remove them, and that's the tube complement. Now, we have outputs for each channel here and inputs. High-level input, preamp out, external speaker out. External speaker out, preamp out, and high-level in, line in. And then this is storage compartment and storage compartment. So that's basically the machine. And here is the grill for the venting of it. And the fan is back here, so there's plenty of ventilation for this machine. We've seen it play. We've heard it play. We've seen it fast forward. We've seen it rewind. How does this thing work, and why is it that this is probably one of the last machines that will ever survive? I've only seen two of these stereo, I've seen three Telectro stereo machines. One, and they're all on eBay. One is selling for $1,900, and it's a solid walnut case, but it's basically this mechanism. Good luck to the guy if he can sell it for $1,900. The next one I saw is similar to this. It's the model before this one, and it's really a mono machine that will play a stereo tape, but it will only record in mono. And it has some dents in the speaker grills, and it doesn't look as nice as this. This machine came up, and I got it. It was sitting on eBay for quite a while. People weren't interested in it. And I, about 5 or 6 years ago, I found one of these machines on eBay, but it was so water damaged that it just wasn't worth any money, because I knew that it would not be restorable. But this one, I was lucky. It was in pretty good condition. There's no cosmetic problems with it at all, and it does work. The Telectro machine is based on a European design, from what I understand, of European tape recorders, which isn't all that much, but I've had some experience with Ewer and Grundig. And what I find happens with the European design is they don't use a deck system like the Japanese do, where you have a deck with all the components on it, and then there's flying bridge for the heads and the pinch roller and all that kind of stuff. What they do is they have a main chassis plate here, and there may be a fascia on top of it for appearance sakes, and then all of the mechanics are behind this and bolted to the plate. Telectro did something very common in the late 50s, early 60s, and that is they used rivets to hold most of the machine together. This is always a problem because when you're using rivets, you can't take anything apart. It's just permanently made. So we see rivets here, all going through the main chassis plate. Now these are screws that hold on the fascia plate. And these rivets are, as we'll see when we look at the other side of the machine, they hold the motor assembly and some other things to this plate and cannot be removed. So it's very, very difficult to service. So here we see three lights, and those light up the indicators on the front panel when it's all put back together. I have the controls here to show basically how the pressure pads and pinch roller and the safety interlock work. So let's take a look at that. When you put it into play, notice that the plate here comes forward, and that's your pressure pad. And that comes forward and, of course, engages the head. Now, there's a record playback head, and here's an erase head right next to it. It also moves the pinch roller into position against the capstan, as you would expect. And it also releases this safety switch so that when the tape runs out, the machine will turn off. And then when you put it back to stop, obviously it all disengages. So that's not real clear from the outside of the machine when it's all put back together, so that's why I want to show you here. And this is the micro switch that works with the safety interlock switch. So watch this switch. I may not have noticed it, but here is a little piece that moved, and that's the on-off. So that's basically all that we need to see here. What's really important is to see the back of the machine, so you can see the mechanics. We're looking at the back side of the chassis plate, where everything is bolted to it, and we can see that this is a simple mechanism, but it's a complex mechanism because it can't be serviced. And part of the reason it can't be serviced is they built it in layers and just added a layer on top of a layer on top of a layer without any way of removing them. And the SAMS PhotoFac manual is extremely poor in explaining any of this machine. But let's take a look at what we have to see what we can do. Okay, here's obviously the electronic circuit. Now this is a tube machine, but I've taken the tubes out, obviously, to work on it. All of the mechanical parts that turn the machine on, turn the machine off, you know, put it into forward, put it into reverse, rewind, fast forward, and so on, all controlled from mechanism that's located under this plate. Now, how are you going to get underneath that plate? You can't. Here's what happens. You've got a switch here wired to this circuit board that has a spoke coming up that goes to a clamp, and that's your record play switch. Here is another switch that handles the stereo mono, and that's all bolted to this area. You can unscrew that. There are two hex head screws that you can't even see through the wiring here, but this doesn't move. You would have to take this out. Now, to take that out, you have to undo all sorts of rivets, so this chassis doesn't come out easily. There are screws here for it, but very hard to get to the screws. And I spent, you know, months on this machine, and I just can't get it apart. And the SAMS PhotoFac is not really helpful for that. Okay, here we see the motor. And the motor is actually free-floating. Now watch this. Let me try and do it this way so you can see it. See how that moves? The motor is mounted to this plate, but this plate is mounted to the tape recorder by this one fulcrum point. And of course, this is designed to be standing up, which it's not doing right now. So the fulcrum point isn't doing, you know, its job right now, but it's not meant to be used in this position. But the motor moves back and forth. Now, why does the motor move back and forth? That's because we see here there's fabric belts. Fabric belt here and a fabric belt over here. You may not be able to see that one. Very much like what we saw in the Sears series of videos that I did on the stereo Sears machine that used fabric belts, and I had to replace the belts. These belts are very strong. They're very well made, so I hope they'll last. But what happens is to engage the rewind, they have to move the motor this way to create enough tension so that the belt will work. The same thing for fast forward. They move the motor this way, and then the tension on this belt increases. And then for take up, the motor has a spring here that is constantly pulling it in this direction so that there's always a little bit of tension on this belt. That's the simplified way they make it. Now, also with this, there's a rubber belt that goes around the capstan. Well, where's the capstan flywheel? Oh, good luck finding it. It's way buried down in here. Will it come out? Nope. There's no way, and there's several reasons for that. Now, you'll notice that there are three capacitors here. Those are the replacement capacitors for the main power capacitor. There's actually a fourth one here, and the main power capacitor is here. This is what they had used, and it was located underneath this plate here. Okay, so you can see kind of the position it was in. And so when I put the new capacitors in, I put them as close to the points where the wiring on this capacitor had been soldered to the circuit board. And the reason I did that is to reduce the chance of hum. Now, as I say, there are several tubes that go in here. I also recapped this amplifier, so there's some new caps in here. I use the smallest caps I can because I didn't know how much room I had. And this thing generates a lot of heat because it's got several tubes in here. So I didn't want the caps to overheat. And many of them are unfortunately located rather close to the tubes. So there's an issue with that. Now, what is this thing? Well, this is an interlock for the record play switch. It just simply goes up and down. And let me see if I can move it. Not sure that I can. There we go. And that's all it does. It just goes up and down. The mechanism that works with it is under here, which you can't get to. Okay, to get the motor out, you would remove this bolt, but it has a plate here that's all wound around back inside and doubles back on itself onto these plates. Here's one example of the plate. There's another one on the other side that you can't see because of the camera angle. That's what's bolted to the main chassis board. You can't get that out either. So this is not a service-friendly machine. In fact, this is one of the most unpleasant machines I've ever had to work with. I don't mean that the machine itself is unpleasant. I mean doing the work was not fun, and it was not enjoyable because it's so frustrating. You know, you see something, I got to fix this. Ah, how do I get to it? I know that Telectro didn't last that long. They were part of Emerson because of financial issues, and eventually Emerson completely replaced the line with their own brand of tape recorders, which we have seen in the video Tape Recorder from Mars, which was an Emerson monophonic version of what was basically a tape recorder that was based on Telectro designs but radically changed to make it much more user-friendly. Thank you for watching this video about the Telectro model SS233 stereo tape recorder from approximately 1965. I hope you enjoyed looking at this machine, and there's not much to say about it because it is so difficult to service. It's so difficult to show anything. There was no point in going through that. I preserve this because I consider it the last of its kind, and I hope that I've done a good thing by doing that. The tape recorder people will be very happy, I hope. But it was a unique machine at its time, and it obviously did sell. So we're preserving a bit of history here, and we're grateful for the history, because without the history of tape recorders, we wouldn't have the digital wonders that we enjoy today.